Hello and welcome to this, the first in a series of webinars on the topic of stage construction analysis. So the webinar series breaks down as follows. There'll be two introductory webinars, followed by four where I'll go into the detail on different aspects of stage construction analysis and its results, and then a summary where I'll try and pick out the key takeaways from each of the preceding webinars. So this one, an introduction, what is stage construction analysis? Well, a general definition for stage construction analysis is that it's an analysis procedure which recognizes the changing state of a structure over time. So each stage, any or all of the following may change. The extent of the physical members included in the model, material properties, and that's a way to deal with time-dependent effects, and the applied loading. So an internet search on this sort of topic will give you many similar definitions. And you'll also perhaps encounter the term stage construction analysis and the other another term construction stage analysis. So I think both these terminologies are basically the same, talking about basically the same thing or an analysis with the same capabilities. But perhaps the focus can be different. So sometimes your concern might be to deal with more onerous design stages during the construction of something like a bridge. So there, it's possible for aspects or elements in that structure to have the worst design case during the construction. In buildings, however, the concern is usually to recognize the impact that the construction loading history has on the completed structure. So that's all a bit abstract. Let's start by thinking about it in terms of an example. So I've got a simple example here, a simple 2D frame. Obviously two columns, three beams. The beams at each level are the same size. And there's another column here, which is an engineer aspect. You might be thinking that this column supports this top level beam, but basically it's connecting the beams. And the only loading I'm going to consider is a single point load applied on the center of these three beams. So when I run a traditional 3D analysis without stage construction analysis, if you can imagine that that structure was fully constructed before any load existed, and then you applied those 3 point loads, then the beams would all deflect equally, and they're constrained to do that by the existence of that column. And you would see a roughly equal bending moment in each of the beams. If, however, you were to construct that base level first and then load it at that point in time, then you would see the bending moment that would be roughly equivalent to the one that we had up here. It's actually a little bit higher because a little less stiffness at the support there. And then if you were to add the next level and then add the load at that level, then as it deflected down, the level below will deflect down. So the load for the level two will start to be shared roughly 50-50. And then when you do the same again, the load from the third level gets shared roughly 33% to each level. So you end up with this much higher bending moment at this bottom beam than you had from the traditional 3D analysis. So that's the sort of most basic classic example that you tend to see of why stage construction analysis makes a difference. If I take that example a little bit further and do the sort of thing that we as engineers tend to do, I've got a structure here where I can't have a column at this level, so I need to create a transfer level. So I've got a big transfer beam and then two smaller beams. I'm going to apply the load as UDLs at each level. And the ratio of the depths of these beams is so such that you've got the same span to dip depth ratio at each level. So this bottom beam is twice the size of that beam. And running that one through on a 3D analysis, a simple non-staged analysis, then you would see results like these. So you get a big bending moment in the transfer beam, and you know, you've got no immediate way of saying is that right or is it wrong, was it what I expect, and then you have at the upper levels things that's where engineers look at it and start to say, well, hang on, this is not really what I'm expecting. So I'm expecting to see this is a two span beam with a hogging moment at the central support, so I'm not seeing that. If you did some work to where you chased down the load and worked it out what sort of bending moment you'd expect from the point load arriving on this bottom beam, you would also work out that you expected a bigger bending moment than this. So that's one of the reasons why people start to look at stage construction analysis. They'll run a stage construction analysis and you will see a bigger bending moment down here. But even then, you still might not see what you're expecting back up here. So on this top beam, yeah, I'm seeing hogging, but is it big enough? Is it really what I expected? And on the middle beam, because of this shading effect that I talked about earlier, I'm still not getting a hogging bending moment there. So again, does it meet your traditional expectation? And I'll say a little bit about more on that topic of traditional expectation shortly. So I've got another example where stage construction analysis starts to be looked at as making a difference. So a slightly more realistic structure. I think it's about a 15-story building, two cores providing stability, columns, and I've got a very simplified beam system here. So I'm going to focus on the results on this frame two here. And when I got the results on the left from a 3D analysis, as it gets loaded and there's stresses build up in this column, you see more and more deflection of the column, and the core walls to the side of it are less heavily stressed on average and deflect less under that load. In the stage construction analysis, you see less deflection here. And when you look at those deflections in mind, when you look at the bending moments, for the 3D analysis, I see the sort of expected bending moment profile down here at the bottom. And as I go up the structure and as this central column is moving down relative to these edges, I see less and less hogging moment here and a bigger and bigger support moment over there. So that's an unexpected result from some people's points of view. When I run the stage construction analysis, I see very similar results for the bottom beam, but as I go up, without getting that so much deflection, this is deflection subsequent to the creation of the members, then I get the same sort of effect building up in the lower part of the building, but it doesn't become as extreme and it becomes back to something that's more expected as I get towards the top. So stage construction analysis, what is it? Well, first of all, I'd ask you to remember that all structural analysis includes assumptions and simplifications. So a quote that I like to put in these sorts of webinars, engineering, and some may think FE practice also, is the art of modeling materials we do not wholly understand into shapes we cannot precisely analyze so as to withstand forces we cannot properly assess, this in such a way that the public and hopefully the customer has no reason to suspect the extent of our ignorance. So that comes from Arthur T. Murphy and the structural engineer. And that applies to everything that we're doing with analysis. So in a traditional 3D analysis, construction stage loading effects are ignored. And that's been a widely accepted situation for many years. What SCA does is it allows you to start investigating those effects. But I'd encourage you to try to avoid thinking that you have suddenly got an analysis where you can get correct results. You might get many different results from SCA depending on the input that you give. So what will emerge through these webinars, I'll show this sort of view of things quite a while, quite widely. We've got traditional 3D analysis results, which don't always tally with expectations that are derived from traditional subframe analysis. So the traditional practice of breaking a model down into looking at it level by level and then chasing load down through the structure. So you've got these two things which we might regard as being extremes of possible design for results. And then you've got stage construction analysis which can produce results somewhere within this range. Where within this range depends on the input, most notably the load level during construction. And so sometimes SCA can give results that seem less unexpected. And that's really the first reason why SCA becomes requested by engineers using software. So SCA, why is it wanted? It's a more realistic method of analysis based on for people who've encountered the sort of examples I've shown. But you might also think of it as a less unrealistic method of analysis. So basic 3D analysis starts with this assumption that the whole building comes into existence without any load existing, and then the load gets applied. Second reason is that in some areas, checking authorities are starting to require the use of stage construction analysis, particularly for taller structures. So people are encountering that. Another reason is that, another thing that people ask for is that they want to be able to use different distance adjustment factors for different loading conditions. So they're maybe not requesting specifically that SCA, but that is a capability that SCA delivers. And then finally, there's just a concern that I've encountered things and my designs won't be safe if I don't use stage construction analysis. Now, potentially that's true if you've been using software where you're just using 3D analysis and nothing else, and you're going to use stage construction analysis. I would even sort of caution against being too worried about that as well, but that doesn't apply if you've been using Tekla Structural Designer. So just to put, I'm going to nick a slide here from webinar 6, looking at this range of results again. So I've got, and I'm looking at that same example where I've got the transfer beam here, taking the load. I've got the results from a traditional 3D analysis, and then I've got results from a chase down analysis. So this is where we've got this capability in TSD to do this analysis floor by floor, get the loads and chase them down the columns. And that sort of punishes this transfer beam in the way that is more traditionally expected. So in that analysis, we see equal hogging moments in these upper level beams and the expected level of load in the transfer beam. We've got the 3D analysis here, where we're getting less bending here, but we're also getting big sagging moments here and big hogging moments here in these upper level beams. And that's an extreme that's unlikely. So stage construction analysis, we're showing here examples of it producing different results based on different types of input. So we can reduce that hogging moment, reduce that sagging moment by different amounts, depending on the input. And I'll deal with that in the later webinars. But the point is that stage construction analysis can be used to exclude some unrealistically extreme results at this end of the range, and therefore potentially produce slightly more efficient designs. So stage construction analysis, why is it wanted in TSD? It's for exactly the reason that I've just been describing. So in previous TSD design, we considered both of these extremes. So the complaint or the concern is that we might be being overly or unnecessarily conservative in some situations. So for future TSD design, some sort of envelope is still required. And we can use stage construction analysis to exclude this traditional 3D analysis and remove some of these unrealistically extreme results. And that brings me to the end of the first webinar. Thank you.